Test. Check one. Check one. Check two. Check.
Talk like this. 400 years of African American music history. Said slower. 400 years of African American music history. Thank you.
Testing 1, 2. Check one. Check one. Testing 1, 2. Check one. Testing 1, 2. Check one. Thank you.
Good afternoon. I'll try that again. Good afternoon. Hi, everybody. So glad to see you all come back again for what is now our third week. I hope you all enjoyed all the music and talent that we saw last week. It'll be another packed full day today. I want to let you know that that music that you heard just beforehand is Calvin's Gospel Choir. And as most of you know, they are going to kind of wrap up this class in a concert on Saturday, October 1 at 7 o'clock p.m. in the Covenant Fine Arts Center. So that's not this building, it's the larger auditorium. It's general admission, there's no tickets required, so we hope that you'll come and enjoy that. That's part of our homecoming weekend, so we expect a full crowd. But we can seat 1,000, so don't worry about that. I want to thank again the Michigan Humanities for the grant for this class, and also thank all of our participants for the hard work that they've done. And I will turn it over to them now with our blessing.
Good afternoon. Please join me in a word of prayer. Lord God, creator of all things, all creatures, Lord, your majesty, your holiness, your purity overwhelm us. Lord, we're so grateful to you, God, for what you do in our lives and the work you've done in this world. And even though it may seem like things are in the midst of chaos, God, we are reminded to have hope because of the one you sent who embodies hope, your son, Jesus Christ. So, Lord, as we share this time today, please fill this place with your Holy Spirit. Let all ears be open to be heard, to hear, and be touched in the way that each individual will need to be touched. As only you can make that happen, God. In the name of Jesus the Christ, amen. 400 years of African-American music history. We've traveled quite a ways, haven't we? These last two sessions. And there's a richness to that music history, but there's also a richness to the history. Session three we're calling Struggle and Change. Coming out of the Civil War and then leading into Reconstruction, which had so much hope, and there's so many failures, so many dreams and aspirations that were not fulfilled, that because we didn't do the work during Reconstruction, they bequeathed to us a troubled 20th century that still left unfinished business that requires us to continue working on that unfinished business in the 21st century. Let's start here. In the book of Matthew, chapter 24, verses 3-8, it says, as Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives, the disciples came to him privately. Tell us, they said, when will this happen? These things you've been talking about. And what will be the sign of your coming and the end of the age? Jesus answered, watch out that no one deceives you. For many will come in my name claiming, I am the Messiah, and will deceive many. You will hear of wars and rumors of wars, but see to it that you are not alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come. Nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be famines and earthquakes in various places. All these are the beginning of birth pains. Scholars of Call, scholars of Calvin University, can there be any doubt that the 20th century was a century of wars and rumors of wars, with famine, plague, and all kind of disasters befalling humanity? The 20th century will go down as the most violent century in all of humanity, which is quite an accomplishment since all centuries of humanity have been pretty violent. How do you take, for example, a bucolic, innocent-looking scene like this and turn it into this, World War I? If the earth were an organism, do you know what kind of violence you would have to do to turn the land to something looking like that? This takes focus. This takes intentionality. This takes using the worst tools you can imagine to gouge out a living organism to produce this kind of disaster. What kind of ferocity produces this? What kind of evilness of spirit causes you to damage the only planet you live on with this kind of wanton cruelty and destructiveness? The American president during World War I, Woodrow Wilson,
the 28th President of the United States of America, made a speech on April 2nd, 1917, drawing America into war. He said that it had to be the war to end all wars during that speech, when he went to the Congress asking for the declaration of war. But it's interesting that Mr. Wilson said that it had to be the war to end all wars because he overlooked that there was a war going on in his own country. You see, this was the same president who gave a positive assessment of the Ku Klux Klan's portrayal in the movie Birth of a Nation in 1915, which, among other things, led to their revival. A revival not necessary since black people had been pushed back into the shadows and on the margins yet one more time. The cultural war had been won by dominant society. Black people had been told, you're not wanted, you shall not vote, you are not equal, and they had gotten the message and tried to disappear to survive. And yet they came anyway, the domestic terrorists. Black soldiers fought in World War I. Elements like the Harlem Hellfighters, which scored some of the most outstanding records during World War I. And yet, when they came back home, the words of Wilson hung in the air. The world must be made safe for democracy. Americans must fight for the rights and liberties of small nations and to bring peace and safety to make the world itself at last free. This spoken by a president who presided over the ransacking of East St. Louis, Chicago, East St. Louis, Missouri in 1917, to Chicago race riots in 1919. And then eventually, what happened in Tulsa, Oklahoma in 1921, although he would have been out of office by then. But after World War I ended, there was still big trouble ahead. Big trouble in the form of these two monsters of humanity, Adolf Hitler and Benito Mussolini. The Italian dictator to your far left, and the Nazi dictator to your far right. Of the two of them, the greater evil was this one. Both were problematic. Both brought misery to millions of people, 50 million people around the world. Here he's saluting to the Waffen SS in their black uniforms. On September 1st, 1939, the Wehrmacht and the Luftwaffe invaded Poland, initiating World War II in Europe. The things that the Nazis did still defy imagination. They still don't do justice to the word unspeakable. They still require more words to understand, how do you wage war on children? How do you wage war on the innocent? How do you wage war on the infirm? How do you wage war on people who are guilty of simply having been born? And then there was this guy, Hideki Tojo, the leader of the militarists in Japan. The Japanese imperial flag had been alive and well and causing trouble in Asia since 1931 when they invaded Manchuria and renamed it Manchukuo. But on December 7, 1941, worsening relations between the United States and Japan finally culminated in the attack on Pearl Harbor in Hawaii. Like World War I, like the Civil War, like the Spanish-American War, the Civil War before it, the Mexican-American War, the War of 1812, the American Revolution, when 5,000 black men served in the Continental Army, as also what happened in World War II, African-Americans served in World War II. For example, Dory Miller here. Dory Miller was a seaman who shot down four Japanese aircraft on the morning of the attack on Pearl Harbor. You see, the thing about Dory Miller was that, like other people in the Navy during World War II, black men, the only job he was allowed to have was as a cook or a steward. That is, to either cook the food or serve the food or clean up after the people that ate the food. He shot down four Japanese aircraft that morning and won for himself the Navy Cross. There's only one medal higher in the Naval Service than the Navy Cross. That's the Congressional Medal of Honor. That's how heroic he was. President Roosevelt said, we need to fight for democracy at home and abroad. So African Americans fought in the Pacific Theater, and of course they fought in the Marine Corps. It took the Marine Corps a while to finally let African Americans join the Marine Corps. It wasn't until 1942. And then when they did join, they had to train at a base on the other side of Camp Lejeune, North Carolina. I speak from personal experience because I was stationed there for a bit. And then, of course, there were the legendary Tuskegee Airmen who who fought in the skies over Europe. There was an ongoing debate between the British and the Americans about whether or not bombers could take off from England and fly unescorted to their bombing target. The Tuskegee Airmen were called upon to escort them, and the losses went down. And the 761st Tank Battalion, African Americans were in the first wave that hit the beaches on D-Day, June 6, 1944. African Americans were there when the Nazis surrendered in May 1945. African Americans eventually became part of the occupying forces in Japan when the Enola Gay, piloted by Colonel Paul Tibbets, dropped the atomic bomb on Hiroshima on August 6, 1945, and Nagasaki on August 9, 1945. Japan surrendered. Americans, black and white, male, female, had gone to war, 12 million of them in uniform by the end of the war, to fight for democracy, to defeat tyranny abroad. America had a victory. The real question was, would that victory abroad equal justice and full citizenship at home?
Good afternoon. Good afternoon.
I'm glad you're still hanging in there with both of us and the three of us. The years that we're talking about are 1946, that's my birth year, to 1968, the beginning of my senior year of college. I don't know how that was chosen. Was that your choice? Okay. So there's so much music that took place during that time, and we were just, our heads were swimming. How are we going to cram this in 30 minutes? But, you know, we're not going to talk about spirituals today since we had talked about it, but it still continues in this period. We're going to talk a little bit about bebop. We have a guest artist that's going to join in with the cool jazz. I'm not going to talk about hard bop. I wish I could. We'll talk about blues, rock and roll, gospels, and some singers. And I'll leave the classical music to the next session, I hope. That's not bebop. Where's that from? That's the swing era. Most popular decade as far as jazz is concerned, though it's not always considered jazz. It's kind of pop music. People were dancing. They just flocked to these bands by the groves. Bebop was kind of the antithesis of that. It was a little more conservative in what they did. Is that why it's ringing? Okay. Bebop was a style of music that started in the mid-40s. It actually started before 1945, but they had placed a law, the American Federation of Musicians had placed, prevented the musicians from publishing this music and recording it. Thus, we don't really have documentation of the beginnings. This music is fast. It's complex harmonies, numerous changes of keys, instrumental virtuosity, and improvisation. It's reminiscent of romantic period where you had composers really writing music to show the skills on the piano beyond the average, or the violin, or other instruments. Bebop was different than swing. I said that it was not music that you danced to. It was music that you listened to, like chamber music. Today you go to a jazz club in New York City or Chicago, or and sometimes here, people don't talk. It's not muzak, it's music to be listened to. You may have something there at your table, some nuts or a wine or tea or whatever it is, but when the band is playing, you're listening. It's chamber music. Bebop musicians took the music of like the swing era and they redid it. This is an example. Mm-hmm. That's Charlie Barnett playing Cherokee, 1939. Thank you. You're good back there. And here's the melody. I wrote it out, but it should be B flat on the first chord if you're musicians. But you can see the melody right there. Look at the second line. Do, 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 boo, boo. Do, 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 do. And it goes on. So what would a bebop musician do with that? First of all, you see below. Oh, that should be off. That's all right. Charlie Parker would take the changes of Cherokee and write a whole new melody, so he didn't have to pay anyone to steal their tune. It's a new tune. No one owns the harmony. And that type of writing is called, when you take a piece of music. Wow, how do I back up there? When you take a piece of music and rewrite it, it's called a contrafact, where you take the changes, but you rewrite the tune. This is what Charlie Parker did to it. You can turn it up. There's Dizzy Gillespie, Big Cheeks. Many notes, Charlie Parker, Max Roach. The melody is still there, same key. So the question is, could you hear Cherokee in there? Could you hear the tune? I mean, I sang some of it, but then you should be able to hear it without my singing, because the harmonic changes are exactly the same. There are many individuals involved in creating this music, but those are three of the leaders of that genre. The period that followed that, when we got out of the 40s, going into the 50s, you had another swing of music. It was the antithesis of bebop. It was called cool jazz. It was easier to listen to. It was, this is something that got that name around 1953. Cool jazz was more relaxed, and the harmonic structure was a little less complex. The arrangements were more formal. Though they improvised, there was less room for improvisation as had been in the bebop era. You listen to the harmonies, there's a little more pastelness in the sound. We're going to, these are some of the leaders of that period. Dave Brubeck, Take Five, boom, 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 you know that. Miles Davis, Modern Jazz Quartet, very classical jazz musicians, very classy too. Gil Evans, who was a great arranger, who arranged for many of Miles Davis albums, and Tad Jones, and of course Miles Davis. I set Miles Davis at the center because he was one of the highest paid musicians of that time, and his recordings from like 1959, even before then, still sound good. So if you had to buy one recording, I would say buy Kinda Blue. I still have my original LP of that, 1959. And if you don't know anything about jazz, buy that recording. It will lead you to Cannon by Adderley and John Coltrane and Bill Evans and Wynton Kelly and so forth. It's an awesome album. The music on that includes all blues. And we're fortunate to have a guest artist here with us today. Lisa Knight is not one of them, but Lisa Sung is. How are you?
I was.
T- teaches here at the college. Come on up to the piano. Now, in the true fashion of jazz musicians, we haven't done this, right? I know we're probably in a key of G, and I want to sing the head and one improv. If you want to improv, and then we can take it out, okay? And that's the way a jazz musician might talk on the stand. I don't consider myself necessarily a jazz musician, but let's have it. And it's appropriate to a clap after a solo. Lisa, Deborah, thank you.
One important thing that I want to point out about that tune.
Oh, that you were playing the bass?
Of course it is based.
Sometimes you play the piano and now you're playing the bass?
Okay. Well, you know, that tune is based on basically the standard 12-bar blues. However, in that song, the tendency is to go from the 1 to the 4. Now, the piano made the change, you know, going here, but the bass continued.
Yes. Yeah.
So the natural tendency is to go to the 4 and then to the 5.
Yeah.
But in this piece, it stays on the 1.
Yeah. And one more thing I want to say about that before we go on, before Fred takes over, is that this piece introduced modal music, quartal harmony. Like built in fourths. So it was quartal harmony, built in fourths, not tertian, built in thirds. And it introduced modes, and modes date back to like early church modes, Dorian, Phrygian, Lydian, Mixolydian, Aeolian. This happened to be Mixolydian. Okay, Sir Frederick.
I almost feel guilty for getting back up stopping them. I was going to tell Sonia the next time we do this, I wanted to do the music and the singing. Then I remember, I can't play an instrument or sing. So let me just continue on with what I can do. Dwayne and Deborah mentioned something about from the 1940s into the 1950s. By the time we get to the late 1940s, specifically 1948, President Truman issued something called Executive Order 9981, which finally, for the first time in American history, desegregated the military. This was an outgrowth of World War II when, because of the necessity to ramp up very quickly the armaments industry in the United States in response to the attack on Pearl Harbor on December 7th, 1941, and then the Nazis declaring war on America on December 11th, just 4 days later, America needed arms and equipment and people to build them right now. African Americans worked in many of those armaments industries, and of course, they encountered discrimination, racism, and all kinds of unfair treatment. Black labor leaders put pressure on the White House to say, listen, this is an American effort. If we're gonna all do this together called defending the country, we need to find some way for people to be treated like human beings at a minimum, both those in the defense industry, but even more so, those who are putting on the uniform to go fight America's enemies overseas. FDR passed a number of pieces of legislation that accomplished that, but it wasn't until 1948 when finally that precedent being set that President Truman finished the job. And the question still hung out there. Would African Americans, having done their part again to earn first-class citizenship, the same thing Frederick Douglass had mentioned during the Civil War, we cannot let the battle end without us spilling blood because they will always be able to say you didn't earn it. So it was the same belief that was in operation from the American Revolution. If we put our necks on the line, it can't be said that we too did not sacrifice for the cause of freedom. But the question is, you can sacrifice for it, will you get it? And what happened was that we had to take a pause, not so fast. Not only would there not be first-class citizenship, there also would be no justice. You see, in 1944, Congress passed something called the Servicemen's Readjustment Act, better known as the GI Bill of Rights. You know, 8 million veterans went back to school on training on the GI Bill, which paid for their education. Let me explain why that is so important. The economy that America had in 1941 was completely different than the one we had in 1945. In 1941, we started that conflict without the ability to make nuclear weapons. By 1945, we ended the conflict with nuclear weapons. It takes special machining and metallurgy and chemistry and all other kind of things to build atomic weapons and to build airplanes that can fly that high and as fast as the B-29. We learned so much on the battlefield, it required new machining techniques, new assembly line techniques, new tools, new types of metallurgy, it needed everything. The post-war economy was gonna need an educated workforce, and African-American soldiers and veterans were legislatively cut out of the educational opportunities that they had earned on the battlefield with their service to make sure that they would not be educated, therefore qualified to get the jobs of the new post-war economy, thereby making sure that they would be economically limited yet one more time. The GI Bill also was to provide veterans a response to a grateful nation for your service, well done, with loans to start a business, loans to buy a home. There's a very famous home housing project called Levittown in Pennsylvania, where veterans were buying homes, and the master who behind Levittown decided that African Americans should not be buying homes in Levittown. Even in 1945, 46, 47, 48, the fastest way to grow wealth for most average Americans was to buy a home, have some real estate, to pass on to your children. Cut out of educational opportunities. Cut out of being able to open a business. Cut out of being able to buy a home. African American servicemen were once more relegated to the status of second-class citizens, service to country notwithstanding. In addition to them being relegated to second-class citizens or their service not being recognized, They came home from having liberated death camps like Auschwitz, Bergen-Belsen, Birkenau, Auschwitz, where they had seen the worst examples of inhuman treatment against one's fellow man, came back home to Jim Crow signs and segregation and lynching. In 1950, June 25th, 1950, the bebop era, or the music that Dwayne and Deborah were talking about, they'll blend it right into the beginning of the Korean conflict, when North Korea came across the 30th parallel and attacked South Korea. At first, the American-backed forces were thrown off guard and pushed down into something called the Pusan Perimeter, and they thought that they were going to actually end up losing the war, but General Douglas MacArthur, who was then the military governor of Japan, was ordered by President Truman to stage a counterattack, and General MacArthur staged the worst possible landing place in the world, Incheon, North Korea. Had bad port facilities. It had dangerous access and avenues and fields of fire. And MacArthur said, I know it's a bad place to land, and the North Koreans know that too, which is why we're gonna go there. They'll never see us coming. They landed there, cut off the North Korean advance, and forced them to retreat back north of the 38th parallel. People thought the war would be over by the end of the year, 1950. The Korean War was the first major conflict where African American and white soldiers would fight in a unified army. In that conflict, there was a young naval aviator named Jesse Brown, the first black fighter pilot in the Navy. He had as his wingman and good friend a man named Thomas L. Hutner. Jesse Brown was from Mississippi. Tommy Hutner was from Massachusetts. And on December 4th, 1950, the sound came across the internal comm system on the aircraft carrier, pilots, man your planes. Got into their aircraft, took off. They were going to go fly a ground support mission for American troops in South Korea. And when they did that, Jesse Brown's aircraft took fire. He crashed. Tommy Hutner was still circling above, just like a wingman is supposed to do. A wingman is supposed to be closer to you than your brother is. And Tommy Hutner, in that very, very distant land, in a very hostile environment and a hostile time, he made a decision to crash land his aircraft near Jesse Brown's plane, a wheels up belly landing. He ran across to Jesse Brown's plane and threw snow onto the fuselage engine because it was smoking. They tried to get him out, but he couldn't because the fuselage had buckled. Jesse Brown could not get out. He told Tommy Hutner, tell Daisy that I love her. When a man tells another man, tell Daisy that I love her, not tell my wife, that suggests that those two men were more than just friends. He used his wife's first name with another man, not her husband. Tommy Hutner said, we'll come back for you. The helicopter from the aircraft carrier came. It was too late. Jesse Brown never went home. Later on, many decades later, Tommy Hutner, now in his 80s, retired from the Navy, got in touch with the U.S. State Department and the North Korean government, and close to his death, he went back to North Korea to try and bring home the bones of his friend to keep his promise, we'll come back for you. The North Koreans, of course, saw it as a propaganda event, and they played it up for all they could get. Tommy Hutner died without bringing his friend home, but he kept his promise. He came back for him. In the meantime, back home in America, although Tommy Hutner and Jesse Brown had somehow figured out the secret to getting along in wartime, these two men found a brotherhood in wartime, thousands of miles away in a foreign land, fighting against the ideology called communism. They somehow figured out how to do that, while back home in America, nothing much changed at all. African Americans, even in the military, even in its integrated military, were still finding the same kind of resistance to their humanity and dignity and decency at every turn one could imagine, at the water fountain, in the toilets. It didn't matter how high, how low, how mundane, or how commonplace it was, you were constantly reminded 24/7 how much of an American citizen you were not. No stone was left unturned. But there was something that black people remembered going back to the time of slavery. Our elders had always said, remember, God sits high and looks low. In other words, God may sit high, but he is not unaware of everything that's happening on earth. If he saw a sparrow fall from a tree, he also sees what's going on with us. The only question was, how long, O Lord? How long?
How long?
How long?
That's a good question. How long? You know, there's so much that happened in this period, but what we're going to talk about now is something that we had talked about earlier, and that was the blues. Some of these figures you definitely know. You should know all three of them. Raise your hand if you don't, because I'm checking this out. You know, that's why we do this class. Perhaps you don't know one of these three, but if you don't, you should. Something about the blues from that period. Anything you want to share?
Well, there's a story about B.B. King's guitar, Lucille.
Ooh, Lucille.
That, you know, I've asked my students, you know, who was Lucille? So, oh, his wife, his girlfriend. Well, there was he had a gig one night, and there was a fire in the building, the venue where they were playing. And so he went back to go rescue a woman out of that fire. And so he named the guitar to make sure, as a reminder, never to go back into a burning building to rescue a woman.
That's a good story. Man, what do you name your bass? Don't tell me. Okay. You can see that we said earlier the blues is a very simple form.
Mm-hmm.
It's 12 bars, it's three chords. It could be a little more complex, but three chords are basically all you need to know for that.
And two lines are the same, one line different.
Exactly, exactly. So that's just an example of that. Protest music, you see the name Nina Simone and Abby Lincoln. There were so many. There are several ways to address your discomfort. You could do what's being done to you, or you can find another way of expressing it. And, you know, as an artist, as a dancer, as a painter, as a musician, you can find ways to use a canvas to express your anger and to express what's going on, or to write a composition that expresses that. So Nina Simone was one. I didn't play her example because you probably wouldn't like the language she used in there. But that's how angry she was about what was going on at that time. And Abby Lincoln, who was married to the drummer Max Roach, have you heard that name? You should do this because I just played it with, I just showed you his face with Miles Davis. There's a recording that she does with her husband just screaming out of anger. Screaming because she's so pent up. But sometime, you know, like Nina Simone wrote a song, I wish I knew how it would be for you. You've heard this before. I wish I knew how it would feel to be free. I wish I could break all the chains holding me. I wish I could say all the things that I should say. Say them loud, say them clear, for the whole wide world to hear. And he goes on and on and on. That's expressing, you know, why, if I had the key to make everything right, that's what I would want to do right now. It's not as hard as we're making it, but somehow it seems complex. This is James Brown.
Some people say we got a lot of malice. Some say it's a lot of nerve. But I say we won't quit moving until we get what we deserve. We've been mute and we've been scorned. We've been treated bad, talked about as sure as you moan. But just as sure as it takes 2 eyes to make a pair. Brother, we can't quit until we get our share.
Black and I'm proud.
Say it loud.
I'm black and I'm proud.
One more time. Say it loud.
My wife and I didn't move here until 1969. We had just, I understand that 1968 was a little turbulent here in Grand Rapids. And my first job was teaching middle school. I'm telling you, all of those kids knew that. I mean, you know, because it gave them, it was giving them permission to be proud of who they are, how they looked, not to try to be anyone else. So that was a way of James Brown trying to clothe these young people with a sense of pride and identity. The next period that we're going to talk about is rock and roll. You know some of these people. Chuck Berry, Sister Rose, Rosetta Tharpe, Jerry Lee Lewis, Fats Domino, Bo Diddley, Little Richard. There's just not room to put all of the names of the leading proponents of that genre of music. But I'm telling you, I'm sure there were a lot of angry parents playing this wild music. What's going on in there? It was the popular music of the late 40s and the 50s, and it had characteristics of African-American music that was related to jazz, rhythm and blues, boogie-woogie, gospel, and country. You could trace some of the blues back to the 1920s. That was incorporated in this rock and roll style. The label rock and roll was not used until 1954, coined by Alan Freed from my home city of Cleveland. And the earliest rock and roll used piano and sax, and it continued, but the guitar started to move into a more prominent place, especially as we got into the 60s. There's something about the basic dance beat which accented a backbeat. Rock and roll influenced lifestyles, fashion, attitudes, language. Parents hated it. Kids loved it.
Yeah.
Anything else you want to say about that?
Characteristic of this style was like the open chords and the this interval, which eventually, but this was, that tritone was considered, you know, the devil's interval. So when you would hear, and all of those glissandos, that was just a bit too wild.
What you doing up in here, girl? Playing that devil's music like that. We have a few examples that we're going to play. Mama Thornton influenced a lot of people. the original. Richard was being a little tame because he could get wild. Yeah. He and Jerry Lee Lewis would just get outrageous. You know, so you saw Big Mama Thornton playing, singing what? You ain't nothing but a hound dog. But when did it become a national, you know, accepted nationally? We had to go to Ed Sullivan's show and listen to this phenomenon, this. Who is this creature that has stepped? Oh, I see.
It goes something like this.
Well, okay. So, but there's no mention of Big Mama Thornton's version of that, right? With Elvis, it was acceptable. You could get people like Perry Como singing Little Richard songs, and it was, you know, it was a little more medicinal, a little more acceptable, a little less outrageous. And Little Richard said once that he knew the kids were listening to his music, but their mamas didn't want them to listen to it, so they would take his recording and put it under the mattress and bring up Perry Como or someone. That's kind of crazy.
And of course, Elvis was profoundly influenced by gospel
absolutely.
And blues. And
he used to sneak
an advocate in giving credit to who wrote this music.
Yeah.
And so he would always make mention of the black artists that did the music.
Yeah, he was going in the clubs and sneaking mm-hmm. behind the piano and going into churches and things. Mm-hmm. So he knew from whence the source of his inspiration came from. Mm-hmm. We're going to move on to gospel.
Yes.
You want to sit?
And I can talk about
I want you
gospel
to.
Because that is my genre and my upbringing. Like Dwayne mentioned, the piano started coming to the forefront as a lead instrument. This evolved from the earlier quartet gospel, which was more guitar driven. So now we have the piano, and then the Hammond organ came along as lead instruments in gospel. And one of the characteristics of this period of gospel was a driving piano bass. So the piano would have to set up the song. So, for example. That could be an intro to the most any gospel song. But that piano. Okay, because you didn't really have a bass guitar back
yeah.
then. So the piano player, and if you didn't have a drummer, you would have to fill in, bum, 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 bum. So that would become a more percussive style, and even in the faster songs. So the piano bass and the piano player had to fill in everything.
You know, what's interesting to me as you're playing that is that I'm listening to the harmonies, and there's a carryover from the harmonies you would hear in blues and that you would hear in jazz. This 1-6-2-5-1 kind of progression is, you know, it's kind of a thread between the two.
And you know, of course, back then you couldn't bring drums and guitars into the church.
Yeah.
So the piano player and the organist had to make up for all of the rhythmic
and the tambourine
activity going on.
Yeah. We have a couple examples. Should I play them?
Yeah.
Tell me how we got over.
Shirley Caesar and the Caravans.
People equated gospel with blues and jazz. They were used to hymns, but nothing with a beat until we started adding one. Now gospel music is a multi-million dollar industry, and many of the contemporary singers in that boom got their lessons from Roberta Martin. She was a singer, a pianist, and a composer, and she also went on to found and operate the largest gospel music publishing house in Chicago.
Their pianist, which is going to segue to our next one, was whom?
The next artist that came on the scene in gospel actually took gospel by storm, and that was James Cleveland. And James Cleveland actually played for the Caravans and the Roberta Martin Singers, and he patterned his own piano style after the Roberta Martin Singers. And his success was through working with choirs. And as a result of working with choirs all over the country, he then established what was the Gospel Music Workshop of America. And his first breakout single was Peace Be Still. So we'll hear a sample of that.
The tempest is raging. Oh, the billows are tossing high. The winds and the waves
Bless God. Shall obey your will. And all you've got to say, Lord Jesus.
As James Cleveland, big voice.
Peace be still.
Yeah.
Let's go. Brother the Ram.
I used to be scared of this song when I was little. My mother, every morning, she would play that song, and I'd go hiding under the bed. So you could probably guess why I was scared of it. That big voice and then the drums. So I don't know why I was scared.
I know. You know, and you look at a couple instances with the disciples in the boat, the storm, or the time that Master just willed me to allow to walk on the water. And he did, until he stopped believing and trusting. So now we're up at section, Master. The below.
Songs of protest, songs of play, songs of prayer. Those songs of protest and the songs that help people get away from their reality, the songs of play, the songs of prayer that appeal to a maker, a creator, a God, to help people bear the difficulties of the storm, all spoke to the reality of what was going on in people's lives. God sits high and looks low is a derivative of Psalm 138, verse 6. For the Lord be high, yet hath he respect unto the lowly, but the proud he knoweth afar off. The Lord sits high. He looks low. He looked very low in 1955 because some very low things have happened in 1955. And the story of what happened in 1955 is told in the faces of anguish on this mother, Mamie Till, Emmett Till's mother. In 1955, Emmett Till, a 14-year-old native from Chicago, went to visit his uncle in Money, Mississippi. Emmett Till's mother must have wondered in the days that followed at what happened to her son, God, where are you? I don't fault her for asking that. If you've lived a life where you haven't had to ask that question, then all I can say is good for you. But anyone who's lived a life at all has lived some through some kind of struggle, some greater than others. This one, I cannot even imagine, nor do I want to know what it's like to lose a child, especially the way Mamie Till lost her son. He was murdered. And the usual recourse was to go to the law to try and get justice. But Mamie Till knew that for people of her background, people that looked like her, justice in America always was not an iffy thing, most of the time a non-existent thing. These two men, Roy Bryant and J.W. Milam, came to Emmett Till's uncle's house one night and forced their way into their home. That normally would be called breaking and entering. And they went to trial, and while they were in trial, there were these kind of jokes being made about what happened. They took him out, questioned him, interrogated him, beat him to a pulp, shot him in the face, and then tied a cotton gin fan around his neck and threw him into the Tallahatchie River. And this, during the trial, was how some of the people attending there discussed it. Emmett Till's uncle, Moses Wright, was one of the key witnesses, obviously. It had been his house. He later told a reporter that he told the two men, look, he's only 14. He's up from the north. Why not give the boy a whipping and leave it at that? What was it that Emmett Till had done so poorly or so badly? One of them, the two men, Emmett was working at a convenience store, and Emmett Till allegedly went into the store, and we don't know, we'll never know, because Emmett Till, of course, is dead. But supposedly he said something like, hey, baby. He did it on a dare from his cousins, who said, I bet you won't go in there and say something to her. He did. He's from Chicago. His uncle said he's only from up north. He doesn't know any better. Why not give the boy a whipping and leave it at that? Telling two men who are broken into your house, breaking and entering, just go ahead and beat him, then leave. That's how terrified these people were. That's how twisted justice was in Mississippi. The wife of Emmett Till, of Moses Wright, offered them money to go. So you can add to that now extortion. They're being extorted. And she was ordered to go to bed. The boy was seized. Then J.W. Milam said to Moses Wright, how old are you, preacher? Moses Wright said, I'm 64. And they told him, if you make any trouble, you'll never live to be 65. Even so, even with that threat hanging over him, Moses Wright was a key witness in court. And when asked if he understood or could identify the two men who had come to his home that night and kidnapped his nephew, he stood up in court and said, dar he. Moses Wright had literally just committed suicide and left the state of Mississippi and never went back. The two men who had been identified before DNA, before the kind of scientific tools that we have to get as close to a conviction as you can today, before then, the closest thing you could get, the best thing you could get, was an eyewitness account. And here was this terrified black man who knew exactly what it was going to mean to him to dare to testify against two men that kidnapped and killed his nephew. He knew what the stakes were. He did it anyway. Why would anyone do that unless they had good cause? And even so, the two murderers still were found not guilty, which is not the same as saying innocent. In a country that said no one is above the law, how could Emmett Till's mother, not think that that was a joke? How could she see that was such a hollow kind of concept? So now what does she do? What do you do when you have followed the system? You've done what you're supposed to do. Your son has been murdered, and their murderers have been identified, but the only person that could identify them, they've gone to trial, and they have been found not guilty. Your son is still gone. Only one person ever came back from the dead, two if you count Lazarus. Emmett Till's not coming back, then or now. How is it possible? Well, in a country with a history like the United States, where, for example, in the 1920s, you find three black men who were lynched in Duluth, Minnesota, you have to ask the right question. Not how is it possible, but more the question, how could it not happen, given that kind of a history? So what does she do now? Being a woman of faith, Mamie Till prayed to the same God that her ancestors had prayed to between the cotton rows. She prayed to the same God that had been with Africans in the bottom of slave ships. She prayed to the same God that had been with people who saw their loved ones being lynched in trees in Marion, Indiana. She prayed to the same God who traveled with Ida B. Wells when she won her anti-lynching campaign throughout the South. She prayed to the same God, and just like that God whose avenging hand had reached out from heaven in response to the cries of the children of Israel, telling Moses, I have heard my people's cries. I am fed up with what Pharaoh's doing to them. And now, having heard your cries, knowing what they're going through, I'm now going to take action. He's shown you what he can do. Now I'm going to show him what I can do. in your new Egypt. My mother used to say, God don't like ugly. He's not too particular about pretty either. And it turned out that after they gave their interview and they gloated about it, that the two guys that ran the convenience store, they fell on hard economic times. You see, the people that supported them economically were the black folks in the community. They killed one of the people from the community that their customers came from, and they fell into bankruptcy. This began a new phase. When African Americans figure, you know something, they've been killing us forever, they've killed one of the children with impunity, with impunity. If you can kill the children with impunity and suffer no consequences, no accountability. In other words, if you literally are above the law, what is there to be lost? Emmett Till was the beginning of what was called the modern civil rights movement. In 1956, there was a Montgomery bus boycott. In 1957, desegregating Little Rock Central High School, led by Daisy Lee Bates, the local chairperson of the NAACP. In 1964, Fannie Lou Hamer, a sharecropper who until just a few years early, didn't even realize she had the right to vote. It's the middle of the 20th century, and this black woman did not realize she had the right to vote until somebody came and registered her. And then when she found out that she had that right, she fought tooth and nail. Fannie Lou Hamer fought until the end of her life to get voting rights. In 1965, John Lewis, the John Lewis, led a march across the Edmund Pettus Bridge, where he and other civil rights protesters were met by Alabama state troopers and clubbed senseless. Then in 1968, the recognized leader of the movement, give a speech. I've heard it enough times. He said, well, I don't know what will happen now. We got some difficult days ahead. He said, you know, if I were in Russia or China, I could believe that this will be happening over there, because they haven't made that kind of commitment over there. But here in America, where they have been putting out these illegal injunctions, he said that I thought that the greatness of America was the right to protest for rights. Then he went on to say that the difficult days were going to take into a land, a promise, but he wasn't going to get there. I may not get there with you, but we tonight as a people will get to the promised land. He made that promise. April 3rd, 1968, the next day, an assassin shot him down, killed him. The next day, he prophesied his own death. How did he know? I don't know. But something came to him and let him know, you will not make it past tomorrow. Your time on earth is finished. You've done what I wanted you to do. It's time for you to come back and be with me. That planet does not deserve you either. Come with me. So he went with him. And we went into another phase of the struggle for change. That's why there was music of prayer, passion, play, and protest. There was much to pray about, much to pray about, play about to escape the reality, and much to protest all through the music.
I don't know about you, but we got a lot of work to do. We really do. We're almost out of time, but we're going to cover this section because it needs to be covered. This is soul. Oh, do you know who that is? Baby, what I say. Yeah. Who is that? Ray Charles, thank you. Somebody knows. Good. There are two key figures that we look at in this soul era, and one is Aretha Franklin and Ray Charles. So, this is Aretha Franklin. What?
what you want. Baby, I got it. What you need, you know I got it. All I'm asking for a little respect.
All right, Aretha, what you gonna do about Ray Charles? Hit the road, Jack. Don't you come back no more, no more, no more, no more. Hit the road, Jack. Don't you come back no more. There were so many styles of music that were happening on top of each other. It's like a quilt, and you just pulled out the thread or whatever you were gravitated to. There were a lot of pop singers of that time. You know some of these singers, some of these groups, the Coasters, Temptations, James Brown, of course, the Miracles, Impressions, Frankie Lyman, and the Teenagers, the Spinners.
Walk past me, you don't even know that I exist. Going out of my head over you, out of my head.
It's interesting to hear different artists take on the same song. That's always fascinating to me, that someone has their DNA that they can put on the same piece of material and make it a whole different piece. Few more artists include Barrett Strong, which I think you're going to talk about maybe, and Diana Ross and Martha Reeves and the Vandellas and Marvelettes, and of course Aretha Franklin. This is not, you know, all of the artists other than Aretha represent Motown.
And we're going to talk a little bit about Motown. One of the things that usually gets overlooked when we're thinking about that style is the music, the supporting backbone of the Motown sound, which means that we have to talk about the musicians of that time. So people usually don't know the names of the musicians. So one in particular was Benny Benjamin. And he had, you know, a signature fill on the drums, which you would know that would be the start of a Motown song. So that was his signature move, Benny Benjamin, or. Does anyone know what that's from? That lick there? Shake it, baby. And then another musician, the bass player, James Jamison. There was also Bob Babbitt, who played out a lot of tunes. But I want to mention James Jamison because he started off as an upright bass player. And so by this time, a lot of upright bass players were starting to play Fender basses, Fender jazz basses, or precision basses. And it became an easy transition from upright to electric, precision meaning the frets and stuff so you could get the pitches exact. But James Jamison played a precision. Matter of fact, this particular bass is a 68 precision that I was lucky to get my hands on. And James Jamison had that picking style with one finger, so I'm gonna play just a typical, you know, a Motown thing. Or So the bass became really, really essential to the Motown sound. So I just wanted to make mention of those two musicians because they were part of that sound. And people don't realize, they think it was just the singers, but it was the combination of having a good band, and they were part of what you call the Funk Brothers of Motown. So if you get a chance to research any more on that, then you can do that on your own. We want to talk a little bit about Berry Gordy, who worked in a car factory on an assembly line. And he had already had a little success in dabbling in music and songwriting, and he had, done a hit for Jackie Wilson. But his first big break came in 1959. A lot of you here know who had the first hit, who sang the first hit? Barrett Strong sang the first hit, and then, so Motown was up and running from there. It actually was originally called Hitsville, USA, and the museum is, if you haven't had a chance to visit, I haven't yet, but I plan on going. I know Glenn Boltice has gone, maybe some of you have gone on a trip there. And from there, other artists started emerging, and Berry Gordy started developing a real knack for what song was a hit and what song wasn't. Like, for example, on That's What I Want, it was originally recorded by John Lee Hooker. It just had that bluesy twang. Then he changed it. Let's do 4/4 so people can dance to it. He wanted to reach a crossover audience. And then he started forming his record label very much like an assembly line. He had, gotten raw talent and made them into the superstars. So the Temptations is a representation of that. And the Supremes, which became the premier groups of Motown. And we know there are others, Martha and the Vandellas, Mary Wells, Little Stevie Wonder had come around at this time. Other budding songwriters such as Marvin Gaye started coming on the scene. And then in 1969, a fresh new sound came to Motown. Now, how would he know if a song was a hit? Who knew the process that he would go through to determine if a song was a hit? Does anybody know? The hot dog test. What was the hot dog test? Does anyone know what the hot dog test was? That's right. That would be the test of whether a song was going to be a hit. And Berry Gordy was also smart because he had other labels, subsidiaries. He had Tamla Records. He had Soul Records. So he could get 4 hits on the radio rather than 1. So he was very, very smart about that. Matter of fact, Glenn Boltice did bring along some pictures, autographed pictures. And matter of fact, this is a picture of me, Glenn, and Smokey Robinson back in 2013. And also, along that time, people were still using the green book, so Glenn Boltice brought a copy of this green book. And so we are going to end our segment with a compilation video through these
arts. It's kind of a factory, wasn't it? I mean, he had costumer,
yes,
a choreographer,
yeah,
someone to show them how to do just
how to
music.
Do an interview. So
exactly.
He had all of those different components of his record.
Yeah.
And he could pump out artists. For say, for example, while Temptations and Supremes were on top, that's when he started with the new artist or the next round of hits. So he kept it running, and it ran basically 24/7.
That's really fascinating, and we would love to go on and on and on, and we could, so we think that we will. So, we're going to end with a little clip from several of these artists. Or maybe we've been shut down.
The best thing in life are free, but you can get.
She said, just because you become a young man now, it's still some ways.
moves. That wasn't by accident. Thank you so much for being here today, and we have one more class next week. We'll go from 1969 to right now. So thanks. Have a great week.